Hello YouTube, this is Free Home Rule, here to bring you a video about my favorite mathematical functions. I make images in PopRay, and these require me to make some implicit functions, and there's a few I've been using a lot recently, and I thought I might do a video about this. They're for general usage, and I'm going to present these with these slides, which contain the info about the images, followed by the images. So, here we go. I'm going to be talking about the following functions. There's a radial function, an angular function, spiral function, an exponential function, a bulge, and last but not least, I'm going to be talking about cell shading using implicit functions in PopRay. So here we go. First up is the radial function. The radial function is basically the distance to a point. So for horizontal distances we use the square root of two variables, and in three dimensions we use the same function with the addition of the extra variable. So it's the square root of the variable squared. This is the images that goes along with it. You can clearly see the radius is indicated by the colors. So red is 0, orange, yellow, green, cyan, blue, magenta, red is the order of colors from 0 to 1. So the first red ring is 1, the second red ring is 2, and so forth. So this is the distance to the center as expressed through colors. Then there's the angular function. This angular function returns the value of the angle as expressed in the range to be in the range of 0 to 1. It's a peculiar function because it has a conditional within the function itself, and the conditional is if x is smaller than 0. And this conditional is 1 if it's satisfied, and it's 0 if not. So the function is the conditional x is smaller than 0 times pi plus the arctan of z over x, that whole thing over 2 pi. So the 2 pi is just to scale this, and the rest is to measure the angle accurately. This is the angle, again from 0 to 1 through the entire space. You people are bright enough to see this is the image that goes along with the function. Next up is the spiral function. The spiral function is a combination of these past two. I'm using these past two functions as the argument for a cosine. And if you use the cosine, which is a wave pattern, over the angle on its own, you get a wave clockwise around the center. And if you use the cosine over the radius, you get a wave that's propagating from the center, like throwing a pebble in a pond. Now, if you add these two, you get a spiral. There's another variable, which is an integer variable, and that's the arms argument. And the arms argument is the number of arms the spiral should have. The 1 makes the cosine go from 0 to 2, and the 2 at the end makes sure the value of this function is between 0 and 1. And at the bottom, we see the implicit function as described in PopRay. Fa is the function for the angle, and fr is the function for the radius. This is for just one arm. 0 is black, 1 is white, and this is for 5 arms. So again, with same color for values. Then there's the exponential function. It's actually a logistic function. It's 0 and 1 for most values. There's a gradient in the middle, and it has two parameters. There's a scale involved and a translation. So the higher the scale, the smaller the width of the gradient in the middle is. So if we take 1 for the scale and 0 for the translation, this function becomes 1 over 1 plus x. So if x is smaller than 0, it will be 0, and if x is bigger than 0, it will be 1. And there's a slight gradient for values near 0. And this is the result of this function. You can clearly see that over the x-axis, it's 0 for values below 0 and 1 for values above 0. And there's a slight gradient in the center. Next there's the bulge function. It's a combination of f radial and for the exponential function. If you multiply the exponential function when it's mirrored, one is mirrored and one is in the right direction, you'll get zeros wherever one of either functions is 0, and you'll get a 1 where they're both 1. So it's an intersection operator. Furthermore, the bulge is circular through the radial function. So the function is basically a positive exponential function over the radial times the negative exponential function over the radial over a scale factor. There's a function, there's the words described as function below and the resulting function. This is the bulge. 0 is again red, and purple in the center is about 0.8. so it's not one in the center, but this is a 3D rendition of the ball. So if you take a minor amount of non-zero values and multiply these two, you'll get a ball. Then there's the cell shading function, using implicit functions. The cell shading on its own is a different way of shading compared to gradual shading or realistic shading. So a real shadow has a gradient to it, at least on smooth surfaces. And cell shading makes discrete sections of shade, like Japanese cartoons, that sort of shading. And to compute this, I'm using vectors and the gradient function, and the angle between the light source vector and the normal vector will describe the shade that has to be applied to the surface at that point. So the vector to the light source at a certain point is the difference in x-coordinate, the difference in y-coordinate, and the difference in z-coordinates between the light source and the point where we measure. Then there's the vector of the gradient, which is basically the normal vector to the surface, and the angle between these two vectors will be scaled from 0 to 1. From this we can determine the shade that has to be applied. And there's the function. It's basically taking two vectors, u and v, and then computing the angle and scaling it over pi. So it will be between 0 and 1. Then there's the shape function. This is a simplified implementation. So I'm going to use the shape of a unit sphere. X squared plus y squared plus z squared minus 1 is 0 is unit circle. The gradient will be computed using the approximation of the difference at a local point. So for dx, we've got the function plus a slight amount minus the function minus a slight amount in the x direction, and then scaling it to dA. So dA is a high number, so we end up with a very local difference in x. The same goes for dy and dz. Then there's the angle between vectors u and v. This is the same function as in the previous slide. And the shader is defined by the angle function with the arguments dx, dy, dz, i.e. the normal vector to the surface, and dx minus lx, dy minus ly, and dz minus lz, which is the vector to the light source. And the angle function computes the angle between these two, scaling them to be between 0 and 1. This is the cell shaded image. We can clearly see there's discrete sections in the shades. This is a fancier function. It's basically a spiral multiplied by the bulge. And this is an even fancier function. It's the unit sphere with the spiral function. And you can still clearly see these images have the cell shading applied to it. There's a few more remarks I'd like to make. You can use textures with the cell shader. So you can not only render black and white images, but cell shaded colored textured images as well. You can use multiple light sources. You can add highlights, you can add transparency. What I dig most about this function is that you can add noise on certain slopes. So in this particular example here, we've got extra noise on the darker sides of the surface. So the darker part is, the more noise is applied to that part. And of course you can cell shade this image again and then apply the same pattern. So you can iterate this a number of times to get a noisier image. The light areas here are without noise. That's the end of the video. Feel free to comment, rate, subscribe, and I will see you people in the next video. Bye!